السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. This evening, I received a call on my way here from someone I've known because I've helped them in the past. And they said something very interesting, and it inspired me to share it with you in order to draw lesson. So what they said is, look, Allah Almighty has said He's going to test us. And there was something that happened, and I know it was Allah's test. And unfortunately, I did the wrong thing. I fell into sin. And so I failed the test. And I heard someone online say that if you failed a test, that's it. You're done. You failed it. So I said, it doesn't make sense. What are you trying to say? Am I doomed? That's the question. And I said, well, today you probably had 10,000 tests without you knowing that there were 10,000 tests. Have you prayed? Yes. Well, then you passed that test. Were you dressed modestly? Yes. Well, you passed that test. Did you swear anyone? No. Well, you passed that test. So you must have passed 9,000 tests. You failed 2, 3, 4 of them. It's not right. It doesn't make it right, even if they're small in number. But you're a human being. You will falter. You did well. You did well in, not because you committed the sin, but because you passed so many of the tests that you could have failed. So it's the way you look at it. Because you faltered in one sin, it does not mean it's the end of the world. In fact, I continue to explain that there are two types of failures. When you do something wrong on a daily basis, that's a failure. You failed. You definitely failed a test. But that is a temporary test. Temporary in the sense that you can make it right. Who knows how to make it right? Anyone? What do? Repent. You must engage in tawbah, what is known as seeking forgiveness. When you say, oh Allah, forgive me, you're forgiven. So what did you do? You failed, but it was a temporary failure. So much so that there is a narration where the Prophet ﷺ says, when a believer sins, the angels hold back from writing the sin for a moment, for a time. That time is known exactly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it varies. It probably could be a few hours. Some scholars say 6 hours. It's held, it's not written. Because do you know what? Before your book of deeds goes up, you repented. If you sought the forgiveness of Allah, there's no trace of that sin in your book of deeds. No trace of it. And if you didn't, in fact, it's the instruction of Allah to the angels to say, don't write it, perhaps my slave will seek forgiveness. Don't write it, perhaps my slave will seek forgiveness. If you do, you succeeded. And you did not fail to the degree where you became oblivious of Allah, because that is the major failure. If someone turns away from Allah for 60 years, 70 years, and one day before they died, say 2 years before they died, a month before they died, a week before they died, they somehow turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, forgive me. I did a lot of things in my life that were not pleasing to you, that were not as per what you have instructed and what you have taught. What does Allah do? The hadith makes mention of such a person that for so many years doing wrong and towards the end they do right, they will be judged based on the ending. And the opposite is true, that if a person does right for so many years and towards the end they have turned away from Allah, they will be judged by the ending. So remember, for as long as you're alive, there is always hope. When you pass away and you have not sought the forgiveness of Allah, then the failure is definitely a greater failure. So great. Then you can say, oh, you failed. But for as long as you're alive, it's just a temporary failure. You can make it right. Allah loves one who seeks forgiveness. In fact, Allah knows you're a human because He made you a human. Allah knows your desires. Allah knows your thoughts. Allah knows what you're inclined to. Allah Almighty knows shaitan will come to you. He expects you to search for him. He expects you to be strong. He expects you to repent to him, to seek forgiveness, to be a beautiful soul, to be a lovely person, to be kind, to be helpful, to be a person who's generous, to be a person who fulfills his or her obligations unto Allah. I can't say, you know what, I'm a good Muslim, but I don't pray. Then you're not a good Muslim, you're a Muslim. But if you don't pray, there are two things. If you believe you're not supposed to pray, then you've got a problem. You can't really call yourself a Muslim because the religion you follow is not Islam. You see, because in Islam you have to pray. People say, well, I don't pray. Well, if you don't pray, there are two things. Do you believe that you don't have to pray? If that's the case, you can't call yourself a Muslim. Rules and regulations are not set by you and I. They don't change from time to time. No, not the set rules, not the pillars of Islam. Not what Allah has ordained. That doesn't change. It will remain up to Qiyamah. If the whole world says there's no longer anything wrong with this, if Allah says there is, there is. There will always be. So Allah make it easy. But for as long as you're alive, Allahu Akbar. Seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will forgive you. Allah will definitely elevate your status. But if you've missed your prayer, but you believe you should have prayed, you're still a believer. And you're a person, perhaps there are thousands, if not tens of thousands, just like you, who are struggling with their prayer. Tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, who might be struggling with their dress code, who might be struggling with other things. There are so many. For as long as you acknowledge that this is my duty unto Allah, the weakness is mine. I haven't got there. Inshallah, I will get there. Make an effort towards it. Have a yearning in your heart that one day I want to do the right thing. And Allah will grant you that goodness. And why I say this is because there are some people that I've met. And we ask them, you know, when you get close to someone, you've interacted with them a little bit more. Or someone says, Sheikh, you know, I have a weakness, pray for me. So what's your weakness? If you don't mind me asking, you don't have to tell me, but if you want to share, you know, I don't get up for Fajr, man. Okay, that's a weakness. I mean, that's something. He says, I'd love to. The fact that the person is saying, pray for me, it means they acknowledge they should be waking up. That means they're believers. The fact that they are asking you, pray for me, is an acknowledgement that I know where I should be. Please go easy on people when they say, you know, I have a weakness. Firstly, you don't need to confess to anyone. Nobody. Islam is a religion where there is no confession to anyone besides Allah. You want to say what you did, say it to your maker, and you don't have to say it to anyone else. Because if you did say it to someone else, that person may use it against you one day, and they are no saints either. You don't come to me and say, I want the forgiveness of Allah. I did this, 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 this. If you trust me and you want some guidance, it's a different story. But today, people will let you down. And you know how bad it is in the age of social media. They just forward your message to another whole group. Before you know it, the whole town knows what you did. And who told them? The fool that you were told them. You don't have to say a word. Forgiven. Allah wipes it out. So the fact that they're saying, pray for me. This youngster says, so pray for me. I said, inshallah, pray for you. May Allah, but I want you to be serious. Met him after some time. He says, Sheikh, you're not praying hard enough. I said, why? He says, because I still have a problem with my prayer. Can you look at how he's blackmailing me? Because he's not praying. Can you imagine? Pray for me because I have a weakness. I can't wake up for Fajr. And then when he meets you after some time, he says, but you're not praying for me because I'm still not getting up. You're not praying hard enough. Come on, man. Don't blame me. Are you making an effort? If I meet you after 10 years and you say, pray for me, pray for me. That's not a good enough answer. It's not a good enough statement if it keeps repeating itself year in, year out. Together with prayer, an effort is required. Make an effort. You know your situation. Let people not be judgmental. You shouldn't be judgmental, and let others not be judgmental. And if some are judgmental, don't take it seriously. It's okay. Ignore them. Leave them. For as long as you know you're moving in a decent pace, and you're moving closer to Allah every day, good news to you, mashallah. Don't give up hope. So I told this youngster, I said, hey, listen, stop throwing the blame on me for your sin. You don't do that. And another thing, you must make an effort. Don't just say, inshallah, I will. Inshallah, I will. Make dua for me. Make dua for me. A guy addicted to a bottle, for example, and he, every time you say, make dua for me, you know what? I have, make dua for me. It's not just dua. With dua, make an effort. I promise you, the doctor, a few weeks ago, like 2 months ago, told me that, you know what? You need to make some changes because of your health. Not to say I have something major, but it was something that really got me concerned. I thought to myself, whoa, you know what? I travel a lot. I move a lot. We've got to make these changes. I decided, no carbs, no sugar. Done. Closed. Today, when I look at things, okay, no means you do have a little bit of a cheat, but very little, you know. Not because I want it, but sometimes you can't avoid it. But otherwise, you come and present me some food, and I'll tell you, not this, not this, not this. When I met Brother Farhan earlier from Saffron, he said, well, should I change the menu? I said, not at all. Today is my cheat day, bro. Alhamdulillah. So Allah bless you guys. Wallahi, beautiful food. You can't come to Saffron and say, I'm on a diet, you know. But did you know how the, did you notice how the word die is in diet? May Allah forgive them. I don't know how they think up these words. Hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakil. But my brothers, my sisters, the point I'm raising is for health purposes, we made a big change. Nobody's going to come to me and say, inshallah, one day I'll change. Inshallah, one day I'll change. The fact that the doctor told you, hey, if you don't make this change, that's it. And suddenly, oh, okay, okay, the change is made. What about Allah? Allah's telling you, hey, you better change. You know what? You don't know how long you're going to live for. Good news to those who are chosen by Allah to change their lives before they pass away. And I've known of quite a few people who led a life very, very distant from Allah. That's why I personally don't judge a soul, because I don't know your ending. You probably would end much better than my ending. But I can tell you something. I know of people who were distanced from Allah, and suddenly something happened in their lives, and they became closer to Allah, and closer to Allah, and closer to Allah, and they passed on. Young age. It is definitely Allah who loved them for some reason to give them the opportunity to turn to Him in a way that when He took their soul away, they were upon the best relation they ever had with Allah. What a good death. May Allah grant us a goodness. Allahumma ij'al khayra ayyamina awakhiraha wa khayra a'malina khawatimaha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, oh Allah, let the best of our days be the last of our days, and let the best of our deeds be the last of our deeds. That's why we tell people consistency is key. You want success in life, be consistent. Day in, day out. You do something, you make sure you are disciplined. Our bodies are created in a way that when you're consistent, the body itself will tell you, you need this, you need this. So much so that if it's consistency on a bad thing, the body will call for a drug or call for something bad or call you towards pornography or something, because you got your body used to something that was negative. It will keep on calling you towards it. When you get your body used to getting up in the morning for Salatul Fajr, trust me, tried and tested, and I've repeated this so many times, before the alarm, your eye is open. It's open. And you can actually turn that alarm off and say, Subhanallah, 5 minutes remaining, look at me, I'm awake. Who woke you up? It's the system of Allah and the mercy of Allah that you got up. That's what it is. That's the body. So when you get your body used to something, it gets used to it. Learn to do the right thing. You'll enjoy it. Similarly, my brothers and sisters in life, like this person told me, I failed this test. Is it the end of everything? Am I doomed? And I said, no. Actually, there are so many tests that you didn't realize were tests, because you're generally a good person. Just like that, I want to tell you, in life, there will be negatives that happen to you. A lot. You find a person losing a job, you find someone health-wise they're going downwards, you find someone who suffering a big loss in terms of business or in terms of something happening in their own life whereby they might have gone through a divorce, they might have lost a child, whatever. Do you know what? Allah says, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Beautiful verses. Definitely with hardship comes ease. And definitely with that hardship comes another ease, which means definitely with any hardship, there are a minimum of 2 points of ease. That's what the verse means. The verses put together, that's what they mean. So if you are willing to be patient, and you have to be patient, why does Allah say,
إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ.
Allah recompenses those who bore patience on earth in an unlimited fashion. Why does he say that? It's because it must be a big deal. That's why. It has to be a huge deal, a very difficult thing to do. To bear patience is not easy. You've lost a job, you're looking for a job. You don't have a spouse, you're looking for a spouse. And you're trying and trying and trying. Allah says, you know what? Your job is never to give up. Your job is never to give up. Do you know why? Even if it was written that you were not going to have a spouse, the fact that you kept trying and didn't give up and kept praying to us, that alone will get you into paradise. How's that? How's that? Imagine Allah knows whether you're going to have a spouse or not. Say Allah has written that you're not going to have a spouse. But what did He teach you? He taught you to look for a spouse, to try, to keep making dua, to keep having hope. So I had hope. I'm convinced. Oh Allah, I know you're going to do it for me. Open the doors. Grant me wish, meaning grant me the best of my wishes and grant me all the goodness. And you're making dua. Oh Allah, I want. Sometimes some people I know, they ask for a specific person. And they say, can I ask for a specific person? Some of the scholars say, you shouldn't. You should just say, oh Allah, grant me what is best for me, my deen, my dunya, my akhirah. My world, my this living in the world, material world, my religion, my faith, my connection with you, and my hereafter. But imagine if you are making that dua, and you are convinced, and you have hope, Allah's written you're not going to have it. Huh? What's going to happen? You will never ever regret the persistence to Allah and with Allah. You will never ever regret the continued hope you had up to the point of death. I met a brother, one of my beautiful, beautiful brothers called Azhar Safwan. I met him for the first time in Qatar. He facilitated so many Islamic programs, massive, huge, five-star events. And I found out some time back, he has cancer. Shafahullahu afa. Allah grant him shifa. I was passing, coming here, and I decided to go and see him at the hospice. He's not doing well at all. Doctors have already given him a period of time that has expired. But nonetheless, he's alive. He's doing well. And I went there and I said, you know what? I said so many things. We have hope in Allah. We have conviction in Allah. While it's important to prepare in case you pass away, your will and a few loose ends and so on, because you have to do that. You're a human. You can't not do that. You can't let your relative say, shut up, don't talk about death because he might not die. We want him to be cured. You know what? Let him prepare. Allah's given him an illness so that he can at least prepare. Sometimes people go with no notice whatsoever. In this case, at least, we're hoping that he's going to be cured. But there's no harm in tying all loose ends and making sure everything's going to be happening. You know, your children, your grandchildren, your business, your work, your passwords and whatnot. You can have a moment to delete a few things and so many other things, right? Hey, at least Allah's given you. So I said we should be preparing to meet with Allah. Yes, correct. But at the same time, we have full hope that Allah will grant you a miracle. Convinced. I am convinced that you are going to be cured by Allah. And I ask her, oh Allah, I know you're going to do it. I'm convinced. Allah will either grant him, because he has granted people, so many people whom the doctors have said 6 hours to remain. I know someone who was given 6 days here in London. Wallahi, it's been more than 6 years. The guy is as fit as a fiddle, mashallah. I meet him and see him and I say, good example, subhanallah, how you've been given this time and you're still alive. That's Allah. What happened? The miracle, the dua, all of the combination of everything. When the doctors gave up and said, you can go home, palliative care and whatever else. And you know what? Next thing, this guy starts healing. How did he heal? By the miracle of Allah. Allah wants to show you, when everyone's given up, see what we do. Subhanallah. See what we do. Allah can, He has. But if Allah has written that you're going to go, What happened to you? You have hope. You kept on saying, Allah, I know you're gonna let me live. I know you're gonna cure me. I know you're gonna give me. I know you're not gonna let me go just now. I am convinced, oh Allah, I call out to you. I gave a sadaqah. I did this. I did that. And Allah says, do you know what? The fact that you made all these du'as with such conviction in me, believing in me, that belief has plugged in on a level that will deserve you my mercy, that will grant you entry into Jannah. Look at the people struggling in Palestine, in Lebanon, anywhere else. They don't. Do you know if I were to describe to you a little bit of what goes on, it would be so, so shocking and so unbelievable. Normal people living a life in an area that is relatively peaceful, suddenly they're told you got to evacuate because we're going to bomb you. And some of them are not even told that. And the next thing, innocent people, men, women and children bombarded. And a lot of the times, the young people who are perpetrating these crimes of genocide on the ground do not want to do it, but they're following instructions from someone. And that's why they suffer later on, and they suffer at the time as well, psychological trauma. There's so much suicide among them because they know what they've did. They've gotten to people who are related to them a few generations back, and they're killing them, and they're brutally burning them and murdering them at the instruction of someone above them. And that's unacceptable. Imagine where and what is going on. Where is Allah in this whole equation? Allah says, we want to take the martyrs and give them the highest ranks of Jannah. Would you rather be a martyr with the highest ranks of Jannah than a person who's struggling on the day of judgment and doesn't even know which way they're going to go? Allah says, we know, we are just. There is injustice on earth, not caused by us, caused by you. Don't blame Allah. People say, where is Allah? The true answer is, why are human beings doing this? Allah told you not to do it. You have a knife. Who told you to stab someone? Who? You can't say, why did Allah allow the stabbing? Come on, relax. This guy did it in front of you. You could have stopped it. No one is stopping it. I feel guilty. The whole world is guilty. Everyone is guilty. Why? Because it's happening in front of us. That's why we're all guilty. No matter who, I am guilty and so are all of you. We might say, I don't have the capacity, I feel the guilt, even though I may not have the capacity. I feel helpless. Really, it's traumatic. Look at how emotional I've become just thinking about it and talking about it. You really reckon you and I have problems? Wallahi, we don't. Wallahi, we don't. It's okay. It's okay. Whatever it is. You don't have a job, fine, you're surviving. You don't have a spouse, fine, you're surviving. Look what's going on there. Spouse and children, everyone buried in rubble. And they're justifying it. And people are cheering them on. It is brutal. It is unacceptable. And it is being documented almost live. What's the point of documenting? People let something happen and they say, oh, we'll do a, what do they call it? Sorry? Yeah, we'll do an investigation later on, correct. Let it die down, we'll do an investigation. So you let 6 million people die, they said only 60,000 died. Why? Because how they count the dead is they count the dead only if they have retrieved a body. Imagine how many have disappeared and dissolved into thin air because of the white phosphorus and whatnot that's being used. Imagine, they haven't counted so many. I would like to take that figure to perhaps somewhere way beyond what they're saying. More than 10 times that, perhaps. But they, and then one day, when the dust settles and they realize the count of it, guess what? Humanity failed them completely. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. So imagine the dua they are making. Oh Allah, you said you are with us. You are with us. You will not allow this to happen. And suddenly, boom, and the person's dead. Where are they going? The fact that they had conviction in Allah. The fact that they worshipped Allah. They knew. Allah says, well, you recognized me. You had, you understood, you recognized, you believed. And that what was of essence. That is what was of essence. You believed in Allah. That is Allah. And Allah took you from strength to strength. So that is something amazing. To believe that Allah has your back. I give you one example of the opposite, where something that Allah instructed people to do, knowing that they're not going to achieve results. How's that? Allah told people to do things knowing that they were not going to achieve a result. Do you know the example? There are so many. I give you one. Here is Allah saying,
اِذْهَبَا إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ إِنَّهُ طَغَىٰ فَقُولَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَىٰ.
Moses and Aaron, Musa and Harun alayhim as-salam, go to the Pharaoh because he's indeed sinful. He has crossed the boundaries, the limits. Speak to him with soft words. Perhaps he will turn so that he may take heed. Did Allah not know in his knowledge that this guy is never going to turn? Right? Allah knew. Why would Allah waste his time, astaghfirullah, telling this prophet to go to the Pharaoh and call him when Allah knew that the Pharaoh is not going to accept it at all? In order to, in Arabic we call it iqamatul hujja alayh. In order for the evidence to be piled up against him, we called you, we told you, and you didn't. Number one. Number two is, in order for us to learn a lesson, that Allah tells you to do things because He wants you to fulfill His instructions without worrying about what's going to be the outcome. You will earn paradise by following the instruction, believing in Allah, worshipping Him, calling out to Him, doing as He has said, even if you don't see a worldly result at all. I will call out, oh Allah, I need to get married. Oh Allah, I want to marry. Oh Allah, I want to marry this person. Oh Allah, I want a job. Oh Allah, I need cure. Oh Allah, I need... We will call and cry and cry and cry. You had to do that. You did it. You passed your test. Don't worry about the result. Leave it to Allah. If Allah doesn't want, He knows. Listen, we kept you in the most blessed way. Imagine you married and we did that for you. We wouldn't do it for you if we knew that the result of it would be even more hurtful than the condition you are in right now. A few days ago, another sister calls and tells me her story. It was so disastrous. And she says, you know what? I don't know if I should give it another chance or not. Now, people sometimes, you know what? They feel soft. They think maybe I should. But if you hear the story, and if you hear how long it's gone for, and if you hear exactly what it is, as a counselor, I'll tell you, sister, while your parents are alive, get back home. It's okay to be divorced. Because this guy is going to do this once your parents are gone and you have no one. And you might just have one or two kids at that time. And then what's going to happen? You have no one and you're going to be on the street maybe. Who knows? So Allah's showing you signs one after the other. You've already forgiven this guy 10 times. Things have been going on for so long. It's time to pack your bags and go home. And the guy keeps threatening to say, watch out, I'll divorce you. Watch out, I'll divorce. How can you say that? How can you use divorce as a threat to a person who's supposed to be the mother of your children, the love of your life? Would you say that? It means they're not the love of your life. It means if you can threaten them, one day you will do it. You will. I'd rather walk out now. Why do I? If it was a threat that came out in anger and it happened once, talk about it. Don't ever do that again. But if it comes out every now and again, it's not just a red flag, it's a bright red flag. May Allah forgive us. So the points being raised tonight are very important, that Allah Almighty, mashallah, today is the first day that my time has not run out, mashallah. Usually I look at Brother Joy and I'm wondering what's going on. Anyway, so Allah Almighty wants us to do what He has instructed. You have hope in the mercy of Allah. You have hope that Allah will do things. That hope alone is sufficient. Imagine when you keep asking Allah without saying, if it is better for me. And this is why it's important for us to add in our dua, oh Allah, grant me this if it is better for me. And don't be afraid of saying that. You know, a lucrative business deal of $1 billion. What are we going to say? Oh Allah, give it to me. You're a believer. You love Allah. You believe in everything. Say, oh Allah, give it to me if it is coming with barakah. Give it to me if it is good for me and my family. I know of many people whom, when Allah gave them what they wanted, they turned away from Allah. Or sometimes their children turned away. Or sometimes something major happened and the whole family split into 20 pieces. Had they not gotten what they were asking for, perhaps it might have been very different. So therefore, be a true believer. It's not compulsory to add in your dua to say that, oh Allah, do it for me if it is better for me. It's not compulsory to add that. But as a believer, when you're in love with Allah and you trust Allah, you will add it. You will add it. Because it's a sunnah to add it. That's why we were taught dua of istikhara. Allahumma in kana hadha al-amra khayrun li fi dini wa ma'ashi wa aqibatu amri faqdiruhu li wa yassirhu li thumma barik li fihi. Oh Allah, if this that I want to achieve is better for me, my dini wa ma'ashi wa aqibatu amri, my religion, my livelihood, my future, meaning even the hereafter, if it is better for me in all these ways, make it easy for me, let it happen for me and grant me barakah in it. And if it is not good for me, not good for my future, not good for my deen, not good for my akhirah, then block me from it and block it from me and turn it away from me and turn me away from it and make me happy with your decree. That's why we say when something you desperately wanted did not happen, just say Alhamdulillah, Allah saved me from something perhaps I don't know. It will be hurtful and painful because you're a human being. It will be hurtful. The other day someone interacted with me saying, you know, I fell in love with this guy. What a lovely guy. I've been making dua. Allahu Akbar. Allah grant me. And you know what? Why would Allah... Listen how people blame Allah. Like I said, the other guy is blaming me. Your dua is not strong enough. That's why I'm not getting up for Fajr. Right? So we blame Allah. Why would Allah let me fall in love with someone when marriage is not written and I only wanted halal? That's because you fell in the trap of shaitan. Allah says initially you're in control. You allowed the first step, you allowed the second one, you slipped into the whirlpool and now you're stuck. And then you want to come back and blame us. We told you from the very beginning, don't even go close. What do they say? You catch feelings. Leave those feelings, don't catch anything, leave it. The feelings, let them float in the air. The minute you catch it, who caught it? You! And then you want to blame Allah. To say, oh Allah, why did you allow me to catch feeling? Not allow. Allah already told you, listen, you want to do something? Yes, it's permissible. Regularize it, do it properly and get it and take it. Honorably. If the guy wants you, he's a man. He must come and honorably take you or he must leave you alone. That's what Allah says. Oh, but you know, now I was thinking I might lose him. No problem, you could lose. He's not the only guy on earth, but for me he is. Well, then you've got a problem. See how we keep fighting with Allah. He's not the only guy on earth. It's not the only. The minute you're married, yes, mashallah. You know what? I'm going to work on my spouse. I'm going to invest time. My children, my spouse. That's important. If you're married, invest a lot of time with your children and your spouse. Spoil them. Invest words with them. See the fruit that grows as a result of how you talk. Ah, mashallah, you're looking so good. Imagine your own father's telling you that. Your own mother's telling you that. Ah, that's amazing. Ah, you're the most gorgeous princess on earth. And we mean it. Those are our kids. But when we don't say it, what happens? You didn't invest anything. You didn't. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. My brothers, my sisters, the tests of Allah, every day there are so many. MashaAllah, we pass a lot of them. Don't underestimate how decent you are. But don't let shaitan make you believe that you're indecent or that you're a person who's away from the mercy of Allah. Because to be honest, Allah's mercy encompasses everyone and everything. That's the mercy of Allah. So these tests will keep coming. And when they do come, we will pass some, we will fail some. If we failed some, it's not the end of the world. You're a human. Repent. Turn to Allah. Allah will forgive you. In fact, he will convert the bad into good on the scales of the day of judgment because you changed your life for him and him alone. And the last thing I want to say is a repetition of a little bit of what I mentioned, and that is when something goes wrong in your life, always try and look at the positive of it. Be patient, give it a bit of time. You will come out of it. Sometimes it's waters that you're feeling a little bit perhaps wary to, you know, to tread, to go through. But you have to. Sometimes you have to. And Allah will open your doors. Don't give up. Never give up on Allah. And don't blame Allah for your failures or the failures of other human beings. These are crimes committed against the instruction of Allah. And Allah Almighty has told us clearly that I told you what's right, I told you what's wrong. I'm going to hold you fully responsible. The day of judgment is actually in the hereafter. It's not in this world. That's a whole day. And you will never run away. In this world, you know what was right, you know what was wrong. When you chose to do something wrong, you make amends. If you haven't made amends, you have Allah to answer to. And on that day, you better have your books in order. You better have your books in order. I really feel for our brothers and sisters in Palestine, in Lebanon, so many other countries where they are struggling and suffering. May Allah forgive our shortcomings. May Allah help them, grant them victory. May Allah grant them their land. May Allah Almighty grant them what they are struggling to achieve. And these innocent people, may Allah make it easy for their loved ones, little babies who are left with nobody besides other humans they are not even probably closely related to. And I remember seeing a video of a child carrying a little toddler, a little infant, a baby, because those were the only two that survived from the whole family, and walking and being asked questions, where are you from, where are you going? Oh, I'm taking my, like an adult, like they're an adult, but only 2-3 years old. And here we are complaining. What problems do I have? Nothing. Compared to that, zero. That's why Allah Almighty tells us, you want to look at those who have less than you, less fortunate than you are. Wallahi, you will appreciate everything. Reach out to as many as you can. Assist them for the pleasure of Allah and see how Allah Almighty gives you. You know, as I'm talking, one point came to my mind. When you give, Allah gives you. When you teach, Allah Almighty grants you knowledge, even more. When you do something, the return from Allah is a lot more. You need to think about it, understand it, believe it, live it, and you'll enjoy it. May Allah Almighty use us to help one another. You want to be happy? Guess how a believer becomes happy? Wallahi, by making someone else happy. It brings about joy in the heart of a believer. A lot of people are asked, what makes you happy? And a lot of the times people say, when I make someone else happy. Imagine you made someone happy, you sat with this person, you gave them something, you did something for them, you said a good word, they were so happy. It brings joy to your heart that you were used to bring about joy to someone else's heart. Allahu Akbar, isn't it amazing? They're smiling because of you. They're happy because of you. What happened? You automatically get the happiness. Same applies to wealth. You gave them, Allah gives you. You want happiness? Give happiness. You want wealth? Give the wealth. And so on. Allah bless you all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.